Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Future Friday. In today's episode, we're going to talk about ammonia as a renewable fuel. I know it's a weird topic, but even I came across it. So first we have to understand what the heck is ammonia. Well, ammonia is a very simple compound. It is from nitrogen and hydrogen. Basically, it's NH3. Think of it this way. Same way you have methane where you have CH4, you have NH3. In both of the scenario, you have something else acting as a bonding agent for hydrogen. Hydrogen is your main workhorse and you want that. So the benefit of that is a very good energy carrier. Now, this is one crucial aspect you must understand. We have to make ammonia in order to use it. It's not like basically methane. Again, you can even specify methane. We can make out a poop. But let's say diesel or heavy fuel oil, those are extracted from the ground. So it's a fuel, so an energy source for us because we are not making it. Ammonia will not be like that. So it's classified as an energy carrier. We're going to manufacture it, then we're going to use it. Now, one of the core aspect of it is like, no matter how hard we try, we'll always end up with some same scenarios. Like we are releasing carbon dioxide one way or the other. This is the only alternative where you can tangibly have a scenario where you have zero carbon dioxide emission, flat out. Flat out. This is one amazing thing about this energy carrier is that it takes your carbon emission and makes it zero. It's not like okay, carbon reduction or something like that. It's like zero. And it, in terms of storage capability, because I specified hydrogen is your main workhorse and you want as much hydrogen as possible, it has very good density in terms of volume. So let's say you have 1 liter of hydrogen, how much work you can do from it? Short answer, zero. But let's say you have 1 liter of ammonia, you can do a lot of work out of that because the hydrogen bonded there, basically the nitrogen is holding them together. You're gonna get a lot of hydrogen per volume of space and you're gonna get a lot more work done. So but you might say okay, liquid, it's a gas, so it's not very dense, but you can liquefy it same way we liquefy LPG, liquefied petroleum gas. We can liquefy this, and here's the benefit part: it does not require as high pressure as propane does. You can easily liquefy this at 150 psi. So basically the same infrastructure we have for LPG tanks and propane tanks, we can simply use that. It's like you don't even have to re-engineer something. It's like, yeah, it's there, just do it. So that's the core reason why people want to use ammonia. So how does it react as a fuel? If you want to use that a fuel, how does it react? Well, it does burn like methane. Now burning is a bit difficult, but it does burn. You can have a furnace, you can have a jet engine, you can have a car engine, you can burn it. So that's a good thing. Then here's another thing. The more advanced option is basically the nitrogen that there is. You remove it, you have the hydrogen, you send it to fuel cell. Now fuel cells are very efficient, relatively speaking. They are up to 60% efficient if you are lucky. So 50% practical efficiency you can get. But the problem is hydrogen. How the heck you gonna get the hydrogen? Ammonia can act as a very good hydrogen carrier. So you can have your normal Honda that is running on basically fuel cell, instead of the just making sure instead of sending fuel cell from basically hydrogen from fuel hydrogen tank, you're gonna send from ammonia tank through a catalyst. Now catalyst will remove the nitrogen and you're gonna get pure hydrogen and everything is awesome, and you're gonna get a lot more mileage. Basically how often you have to refuel, you don't have to refuel a lot. So there are two core options. You can use fire method or you can use basically fuel cell. Fuel cell is much more attractive. Then it has the added advantage of no carbon dioxide emission. Like flat out, no carbon dioxide emission. That is a very big deal. Then you may think, because it has nitrogen and you must be familiar with the industry norms and pollution norms, that NOx emission is bad. So NOx is a unstable kind of oxide kind of scenario where it is not good. Flat out, it's not good. Now one good thing here is that the probability of a NOx molecule to be created is very low. It's not that it's zero, but it's negligible. So if you burn, let's say, 1 liter of basically diesel, the amount of NOx created, let's say put that number to 100. However that is, just put that to 100. But if you burn, let's say, 1 liter or even 10 liters of ammonia, the probability of NOx creation is less than 1. It's almost negligible, like out of flux, because the temperature will rise. And if you have something that is sucking atmosphere and you're not using the electrolysis, basically fuel cell, you have teeny tiny weeny whiny probability of NOx being created. It's not zero, but it is very damn close to zero. And it is so low that the normal catalytic converter that is designed to handle much worse things than this can easily handle it. So you're gonna have negligible NOx emission, like flat out zero NOx emission, and then sulfur emissions. Because it's not mined out of the ground and it does not have contamination, it does not have sulfur also. So that's also awesome. And then you have come to the very interesting one. Now you might say same things can be achieved with hydrogen, but hydrogen is really, really inefficient in transportation. Basically, the only way to safely, quote unquote, transport it is liquefy it. Liquefying it requires it to be, you know, a cryogenic temperature. And that temperature is so damn low, it can shatter most metal on contact. But so the only way we can handle hydrogen is basically compress it. Now compressing it, it's not compression friendly also, because it will not liquefy how other things liquefy. So you can put as much PSI as you want, it will not do anything. While here you put as little as 150 PSI, it's like, I got this. So it becomes liquid. It's very transportational friendly. We have railway cars that can move it out. We have trucks that can move it around. It's very, very transportation friendly. So as a fuel, it has a lot of potential. Now, why do we call it green if it's still burning things or still having things of that nature where you are like, okay, how are you going to make it and all that? And we are going to make it. That's an interesting way. It's not something that we are mining. So how the heck we can call it green? Well, because we have abundant supply of nitrogen. Nitrogen is not something that's going to run out. And we're going to release it into the atmosphere after use. So you don't have to worry about nitrogen running out. So awesome. Then what about hydrogen? Yes, while hydrogen is not available easily, like you cannot just suck up atmosphere and get hydrogen out of it, you can do that with electrolysis using water. And after use, you're still going to get water vapor. So you don't have to worry about running out of either of the two core components. Now, what about combining them, making them? And I specified it is very difficult to make hydrocarbon. Only photosynthesis can do that efficiently enough. Here we know how to do this, because you have to understand, we humans can survive simply because we can make fertilizer. If you have told anybody, like 100 years ago, that humans can like have 6 billion of us, and most of them us are with food in their stomach, they will have laughed at it. Like, our earth soil does not have enough nitrogen to feed that kind of plant, but we created ammonia in an industrialized manner, so we can feed that kind of plant's nitrogen requirement, and we can have enough crops to feed these kind of people. And people like, oh, those are hungry. No, if they were hungry, they would be dead. They have the food, it's just they don't have enough and enough quantity of it. So, and not to mention the number of people who are like absolutely hungry, like bare hungry, those number is going down. And I'm reasonably confident in next 70 years that number will be zero. So we know how to make fertilizer. So that's one great thing. We know how to handle ammonia, how to manufacture it. We have been doing that for 100 years. So we got this. And there's another aspect. It is already industrialized. So basically, if you want ammonia, there are companies right now in every country that is industrialized. You can just call up some number and they're like, yeah, sir, you want ammonia? Okay, this is our bid. What kind of input and output you want? Basically, how much energy you are willing to put in? You want water, or you can get hydrogen from, let's say, steam terraforming of methane, or basically propane or butane. If you have a basically coal power plant, I'm saying gas power plant, you can use that also. So we can create it safely enough, and we can create it in such a way that we're only using electricity to make it. Instead of any chemistry, chemicals, catalyst, we can just use electricity to make it. So basically it becomes a chemical battery in that scenario, and it's quite awesome at that. And we can create electricity from nuclear, from hydropower plant, from wind, from solar. So that is why we are thinking it as a green option. Basically we can inherently make it and will not have like, carbon neutral scenario, we'll have carbon zero scenario. So if everything about it is awesome, and we have been doing it as early as World War II. Belgium had the issue where military appropriated all their diesel supply. So people were like stuck. What the hell they're going to do? So they used ammonia to run their vehicles, and it worked properly. So why the heck you don't see it everywhere if we did it in World War II? So here's the requirement you have to understand. The element, basically the element that is bonding hydrogen, that is doing your work, is nitrogen. It's not carbon. Carbon burns. Basically, carbon plus oxygen is an exothermic reaction. Basically, it's going to give out energy. Nitrogen does not do anything. Or it's going to absorb energy, basically creates a NOx emission. So basically, it will reduce our temperature of the combustion if you are doing that. So you burn it, you have issues that either, if you are lucky, nitrogen will just leave. If you're unlucky, it will absorb energy to become NOx emissions. Or if you are talking about basically fuel cell, it's just gonna leave away. Basically nitrogen does not play a role into the system. Side effect, it also reduces the energy output. Now what does that translate to? Think of this way. I specified in hydrogen car. While hydrogen is awesome. Basically, it's 3 times more powerful than gasoline, petrol, diesel, whatever have you. It's powerful in terms of kilogram. 1 kilogram of diesel versus 1 kilogram of hydrogen. Hydrogen is like, bro, don't even come close to me. However, 1 liter of hydrogen is 100% nothing, while 1 liter of diesel can move a ton. So that's the reality of it. Like in hydrogen, you have that scenario where you have a lot of oomph in terms of mass, but you don't have enough oomph in terms of volume. So, and hydrocarbons are like a kind of balance. So you can have a methane, which has a lot of oomph in per kilogram, but does not have enough, basically per liter mileage, while you can have diesel, which has less energy compared to petrol in terms of kilogram, but in terms of liter, it has more. So there's always a compromise. The more carbon you get, the more volumetric efficiency you get, the more hydrogen you get, the more mass efficiency you get. So there is something there, but in ammonia it's worse than all of those things combined. So ammonia, like if this is a graph and you have like liquid hydrogen here, where you have lot of liter basically kilogram efficient but not of liter efficiency, and you are talking about diesel gasoline here in this sort of region, the basically liquid ammonia is very little. It's like almost half in terms of mass energy, it's half in terms of basically liter efficiency is still half. So it does not have the oomph. Why? Because it has nitrogen in it. Nitrogen is simply like a very close to inert. It's like, yeah, I don't care. So, and when you compare this to methane, which has more or less the same properties, carbon dioxide burns. Like, and carbon takes 2 oxygen with it. It's like CO2. You don't have basically H2O. Basically, it takes 1 carbon dioxide, it can handle 2 oxygen, and it gives off a lot of energy. So inherently, the reality sets in. Like, the people have made cars to run on this in 1970, and everybody's like, this is the future and all that. It simply does not have the oomph to it. Basically, your car is not gonna go far. And if you have a big truck, if you want to run on this, you're gonna consume your fuel like there is no tomorrow. Like, you have to refuel it every few kilometers. And the another aspect, like, even if you could run it on an engine, it has very, very narrow what we call flammability range. Basically, if you talk about anybody who actually designs petrol engines, they'll say petrol, you have fuel, you have air, you have compression, you have temperature, and you have spark plug. Now, we know how that works. We have been doing this for 100 years. So petrol is classified as having a range. Basically, in this range I'm gonna ignite. So okay, we got this. Now ammonia has the same thing. Only difference is this range instead of this is this. To give you a context, in World War II, when they had to create that in emergency scenario, they had to feed in simple hydrogen in order to ignite the engine. Engine was very hard to ignite. Even when Honda built a modern car that was using ammonia as an ignition, only in low RPM it was using basically ammonia. The moment you press the accelerator and it started to go into high RPMs, as high as like 3000 to 4000 RPM, it would switch to gasoline. Simply because the in terms of normal combustion engine, it's not very conducive. Basically, you have to design something specifically for this. The same way you cannot just pour gasoline into diesel engine, here you have to design a completely new class of technology. It can be mixed in. If you have LPG and you mixed in, you could do that, but you get the idea. Like, it's not as clean as people thought. It's like, hey, I'm gonna do ammonia, everything is solved. No, you have to have some way to ignite it, which is very difficult. So that's the reality of it. It does not have the oomph that people want, nor it's as easy as people thought in the first place. That is why like military did not switch to it. Now then we come to the another aspect, that is like final nail in the coffin. It's ludicrously dangerous. Now you might say, hey, even LPG, LNG or CNG or whatever we use, any fuel we use, it's inherently dangerous. While that may be true, but when you look at the diagram, something like this, when you see in any oil tanker and all that, you will have fire hazard 1. So this also has the same thing. You'll have instability. Basically, is it completely stable or is it something that you have to deal with? You will still say it's still unstable. However, if you see, compare that to any other fuel that we have, those do not have health hazard. Health hazard would be either 1, slightly hazardous, or 0, like barely any hazard. Now, when you're talking about this, this is classified as 3. Ammonia is classified as number 3 in basically extremely dangerous. You're gonna need something like this. Basically, you need full body cover suit in order to handle ammonia, and making sure that you, because it's a corrosive, it's not a very strong acid, but it is corrosive enough that it can destroy things. We use it for cleaning purposes. So it's something very strong. You do not want to be trolling around this. The reason we don't die from ammonia using high salt, because it's diluted as hell, like 5% diluted. So as in like 5% concentration and 95% something else. So it is very corrosive. It is that directly translates to your tank being corroded from the inside over time. Now again, it's not very strong, as it's not like, oh, you put basically instead of LNG you put ammonia, one overnight it corroded, but it will happen. So your tank life will go from, let's say you buy a car, you have a tank, you don't think about it, to buy a tank and replace a tank every 5 years. And it's a health hazard, because if you have as little as 100 ppm, basically parts per million, in the atmosphere that you're breathing, it's a health hazard. It's gonna harm you, it's gonna harm your lungs, it's gonna harm your lung. Thankfully, we humans have one advantage, that we can detect it as low as 5 ppm. Now, 30 ppm is like, if you are exceeding 30 ppm, you're about to die, so please run. Now, below 30 ppm, the problem becomes how the heck we're gonna detect it. Thankfully, ammonia is ludicrously staunch. Basically, it stings like hell. And like, there are many people who are making joke, ammonia will have a stinking green future. It will make that, but ammonia stinks very badly. So if you can smell it, run. Run. Don't think about it. Run. So that's the reality of it. Think of it this way: our petrol station will literally become a dangerous spot where you can have people dying or people requiring this kind of stuff. So it's impractical in that way. And it smells really bad. So like, if places around that refueling station will become a death zone, because like, yeah, it smells like a, you know, toilet, so to say, and bad one. So it is very dangerous to our health. So what we can expect in the future, because a lot of people are pouring their money into it. Like, I just came across it today only, but I would provide the video down below where you can see Japanese people are working a lot of money into it. There are people who thought this will become the future, because in 1970 when they did it or things of that nature. So what can we expect in this? Well, it does have limited use case scenario, because there is this one company, GenCell, which uses the fuel cell method. Basically, instead of having a raw hydrogen shipped to the places, they have methane ship. Basically they have ammonia ship, and the benefit, almost all country, even India has like, where you can just call up someone and get a tanker of ammonia. It's expensive, but you can do that. And the benefit of that, they're selling, I do not know the accuracy of it, basically you're gonna have one tanker, is gonna deliver basically ammonia to the tank on site, and it's gonna run on 1 year. Basically it's gonna keep running for 1 year, your mobile tower. So basically you have one tanker for a year consumption wise, and it's cheaper than diesel. Now, how true that is, I do not know. And the problem is that some places ammonia would be very cheap, basically industrialized places. Basically, if you are near a factory that makes ammonia, then it's like absolutely way cheaper. And how efficient the fuel cell is, that also matters, because fuel cells are inherently more efficient than diesel engines. Diesel engine is like, you know, 20 to 30, 50, if they are very lucky, this can go as high as 60. So it does, per unit, it's going to give you more power, and it's running on hydrogen. So it's just using a catalyst to remove nitrogen. So you do have that possibility that it can be true. Again, I do not know how much exaggerated they did that 1 year, that's gonna keep running continuously. So there are certain use case scenario where I can see basically ammonia becoming an actual used technology. Now, can I see it in large scale? Short answer, no, because it has extra steps, and engineering has one simple solution to it. KISS. Basically, keep it simple, silly. You don't want to add extra cells. Basically, if you have to do electrolysis to get hydrogen from clean sources, might as well use that hydrogen directly. Why the hell you want to do extra steps? And why the hell you want to? The only benefit that you are getting is that you are going to bound it to nitrogen. You're going to increase your basically packaging efficiency. Side effect, you are making it toxic, and you're reducing efficiency on both fronts. Not because that. You cannot do anything for magically free. So you're gonna have inefficiency. Let's say you wanted to store 1 megawatt of electrical power. Storing it in hydrogen will give you almost 1 megawatt, while storing it in ammonia will reduce that. Absolutely, it will reduce that. So simple direct hydrogen is better. And I have provided a link video down below where you can see one small town in Europe is trying to do that. So it is much simpler. Now you might be like, hydrogen is fire hazard. So is every damn fuel. It's just hydrogen is much more safer, simply because even if it leaks, it goes up. So in open area, it's absolutely safe. And if you have basically, let's say, explosion happening, first, it does not explode with as much oomph as people think. The reason rocket goes is because it has liquid hydrogen. Pressurized hydrogen does not have that kind of oomph. And the moment even a pilot ignition happens, like even small spark, hydrogen gets pushed out so quickly because it's so molecularly light. It's the fireball will be huge, but the fire temperature would be low. So hydrogen is much more simpler, safer, and it does not gonna stink. So, and not to mention, it's not gonna corrode you to death. So hydrogen, simpler option. Then in terms of what about cars and all that, let's say rather than storing electrical energy, what if you want to run your car? The best thing I ever saw that can like truly solve all our world's problem is LG biofuel. Why? Because it's simpler. It takes efficiency of photosynthesis and simply is like, give me water, give me a little bit of nutrition, I'm gonna extract carbon dioxide from the air, give you oxygen for free, take solar energy, take a little bit of hydrogen from the water that I'm already in, and I'm gonna give you hydrocarbon, which is much more stable, non-toxic option. So it is pretty awesome and it has much more oomph. So in terms of what we can actually, and we have run actual jumbo jets on hydrocarbon, basically on LG biofuel, and military has already run their F-22 on that. So we know how these things work. Chemically, it's all tested. So that's the best option that I ever saw that can truly replace oil. And in terms of what about the development, the money poured into this, there is something good coming out of it, because a lot of research went into solid oxide fuel cells. Now, solid oxide fuel cell is one of those technology I always want to succeed, but for some reason it's not. Now, let's say people working in ammonia field, they pushed it to a point where it becomes economically viable. This technology, solid fuel cell, has a lot of potential, because all of us poop, and all our poop can create methane. All of methane went into this puppy, you're gonna get heat and electricity. As high as 50% efficiency. So there is a lot of, like, this is what we call cross-pollination. You're gonna have one people dealing with one pollution, basically problem. They might solve something that helps someone else. So I have a lot of hope from solid oxide fuel cell department. But in terms of ammonia becoming the next big thing, I'm not gonna have, because it stink like hair. So I'm not gonna put my money on it, but I do expect basically companies like GenCell to really become a big deal, because if their cells really do what they expect, it should be relatively straightforward to convert it for methane systems. And if it can be done, awesome. So this was my presentation on basically I'm using ammonia as a fuel of the future, green fuel of the future. I hope you liked it, learn from it. In that case, please click the like button. If you didn't like it, didn't enjoy it, I'd urge you to press dislike, press it twice to show me your disappointment. Please leave a comment, because I reply to all of them. Subscribe, press the bell icon if you're free, and as always, thanks for watching.